Imagine this, a solid, responsive inspector. Tables, colors, buttons, everything. Complete customization without editor scripts. And only a couple of lines of code. The amount of time that you could save from doing all of this manually is just... Introducing Editor Attributes. Editor Attributes is a free Unity package that you can use to completely customize your inspector with very little code. This is so easy to learn, and there are lots of attributes that helps us do this. This package is made by Volt. He has been supporting this channel for a long time, and I'm thrilled to talk about what he has made. Make sure to stick until the end of the video to know about the practical use cases of these attributes. Let's dive in. First, to install the package, head over to the Asset Store link, or you can download it from the GitHub page, link in the description below. On the page, click on code and copy the HTTPS link. Now head over to Unity and go to Window, Package Manager, click on this button here and add package from Git URL. Paste the link and Unity will download and install the package. You can check for updates by clicking on the update button, and the developer is frequently updating this package, which is great. To start using the editor attributes, you must be using the editor attributes namespace. If you are using assembly definitions in your project, make sure to add editor attributes as a reference to it. We customize the inspector by adding an attribute to a serialized variable or an object in our code. All public variables can be serialized, which means we can add an attribute to them. We cannot serialize private or protected variables unless you mark it with the built-in attribute serialize field. For objects of custom non-behavior classes or structs, we have to use the system.serializable attribute to serialize them. We cannot add an editor attribute to a static, read-only or const fields as they are not valid to Unity serializer. And finally, you cannot serialize interfaces because it does not make sense to do so. The order of execution of attributes is from left to right. In some cases, the last attribute can override the effect of the previous one. In this example, we have a string dialog with a prefix attribute that displays text, and after that, we have a property width attribute that sets the width of the label to 100f. In the inspector, the prefix would not be visible unless we decrease the size of this window. This is because the prefix was set before setting the property width, and it doesn't know how to update the position of the prefix. We can fix that by setting the prefix last or by using the order parameter, which is present in every attribute. The default order of all attributes is 0. So we can set the order of property width to -1 and get the desired effect. Also, we can put each attribute on a separate line if we want to make things look nicer. Check out the official documentation to read more about this and everything else that is covered in this video. Now let's look at some of the most useful attributes. Starting off with my new favorite, the button attribute. This is awesome. It simply adds a button to a function and basically calls the function onButtonPress inside the editor. We can specify the name of the button and it appears on the button. We can use this function to, let's say, randomly spawn enemies or generate a procedural terrain or anything we want by just clicking on it on the inspector. If your function has parameters, they will be displayed under the button as a foldout. We can also enable or disable a button based off a condition as well. This is what makes editor attributes so powerful. We will come back to this attribute a bit later in the video once we discuss how conditions work. Just in a little bit, we'll talk about coloring this button as well. Let's move on to my second favorite, the required attribute. This shows an error box in the inspector when an object field is not assigned. This is so handy when you want to assign references manually via the inspector. Let's say you have a lot of animations for various types of enemies. You can mark them all required and you can see which one has not been assigned. This doesn't give us an error when we play, just a warning sign. The type filter attribute is very similar to required, but it allows the developer to only assign objects that are or derive from the specified types. This is useful to filter multiple types. In this example, we can assign only sphere colliders and box colliders to the field, and capsule colliders or anything else won't work. It is best used to filter types that implement a certain interface. The read-only attribute simply makes the field read-only in the inspector. useful to show things that you can't change in the inspector, but be able to read it. The prefix or suffix attribute adds a prefix or a suffix to a field. One example where this could be useful is to indicate units. For example, float speed could have a suffix meter per second. It's great for clarity. The rename attribute renames a field, but only in the inspector. Useful when you want two or more fields to have the same name in the inspector. This also has an optional case type parameter, which just formats the string on different case types. The title attribute allows us to draw a fully customizable header. You can pass in a string for the title, an optional integer for the size, and an optional bool to draw a line under it. We can also add a text anchor and align the title with the inspector. This attribute supports rich text as well. The hide label attribute hides the label of a serialized variable which it is attached to. This becomes really useful once we talk about void struct later in the video. The property width allows us to adjust the width of labels, not the fields. It gives us more space when used effectively with Unity's multi-line attribute. The GUI color attribute can be used to color the GUI. This means that it can color all labels and fields below it. Here we have assigned three colors in three ways to three groups of variables. We can use GUIColor.ColorName or specify three float values or pass in the hex value as a string to modify the default color, which is white. The color field attribute instead can be used to color a specific field in the inspector. This overrides the GUI color attribute, so it can be useful in many cases. Quick tip, the attributes GUI color and color field can be attached to button functions as well. The line attribute is used to draw a line in the inspector. We can also specify a float for the opacity. The min-max slider attribute is used to draw a min-max slider. We can specify the minimum and maximum range of the slider and assign it to a vector2 or a vector2 int. The asset preview attribute can be used to preview an asset in the inspector. We can also specify the preview width and height. Similarly, the image attributes draws an image in the inspector. Use this while working in a company to prove your dominance and possibly get fired. Let's talk about more buttons. The inline button attribute adds a button next to a property. You can pass in the name of a function using the name of expression, and it will appear right next to the field. In this example, I added an inline button to an integer called lives and connected it to a function that just increments it by one. We can provide an optional label for the button and a float for the width as well. As of recording this video, the function cannot have parameters. The selection buttons attribute displays a bunch of values in toggleable buttons. This can be used with enums and collections, and this draws the values as buttons. You can use this directly on enum variables, but you'd need to provide a name of the collection if you're using a collection. You can specify float for the height and a bool to show label or not. We can add the built-in flags attribute to the enum. This allows us to toggle multiple buttons, just like how you can select multiple values from the dropdown. Speaking of dropdowns, the dropdown attribute can be used to create a dropdown menu of elements. We just specify the name of the array or list, and it will give a dropdown of that. Very cool. You can take this to the next level with the scene dropdown attribute. It makes a dropdown containing all the scenes in the build settings of your project, which means no more manual typing of scene names, which is prone to errors. If this attribute is attached to a string, it will get the scene name. If it is attached to an integer, it will get the scene index. Really game changing. Tag dropdown attribute simply makes the dropdown of all available tags. This can only be attached to a string. This completely eliminates the chance of errors when it comes to tags. Sorting layer dropdown attribute does a similar thing, but it makes a dropdown of sorting layers. This can only be attached to an integer, and we can select a sorting layer. The help box attribute draws a help box in the inspector with a custom message. You can specify 4 message modes. None displays a simple text box. Log is great for logging things. Warning displays a warning message. And error displays a red error box in the inspector. The help box also supports rich text. There are more general attributes that I have not included in this video that are simple, but with less use cases. You can find them all from the official docs of this package. Up until now, we discussed some general and decorative attributes. Now, what makes editor attributes a powerful tool is the ability to work with conditions. Before we get into that, we need to talk about the coolest part of this video, void struct. There is a struct inside the editor attributes namespace called void, and we can use this like an empty field, just blank, which means we can add our attributes to it, and the field is not rendered in the inspector. Does that make sense? It means we can use this struct to create a structure type variable that works as a holder property for a group of variables. This is how we can make complex tables and conditions work very easily. Let's see them in action. The message box attribute. With this attribute, we can add a custom message and pass in the name of a condition using the name of expression, which could be the name of a simple Boolean variable. And now if the variable is true, the message box appears. The condition could also be the name of a custom function, which returns a bool. In this example, we can have a list attached to an empty holder, and we need a condition, a function that simply checks if another list has a duplicate with the help of the distinct function and returns a bool. Now if you assign duplicates, the message box appears. We can pass in a boolean to the attribute to draw the label of the field which it is attached to. In this case, it is the void holder. If we set it to false, it will not render the label of the attribute. We can also assign message modes here as well. If we didn't use void struct, then the message box will appear for each member of this list. The message box also has support for rich text, so you can fully customize this. The enable field and disable field attributes can be used to enable or disable a field based on a condition. In the case of enable field, the field will remain disabled by default until its condition becomes true. Once again, you can use a function to represent a condition and make this thing a lot more flexible. You can also use enums as a condition like this. You pass the name of the enum variable and then pass which state you want to check for. Cool. Remember the button attribute? We can add conditions to it as well. We pass the name of a bool variable or the name of a function that returns a bool. In this case, we need to specify a condition result. Condition result dot enable disable will enable or disable the button based on the condition. Condition result dot show hide will show or hide the button instead. You can also pass in an enum as a condition as well, just like the previous ones. Show field and hide field attributes can be used to show and hide a field, again based on a condition. In the case of show field, the field will remain hidden by default until the condition becomes true. You can also use enums with this as well. The conditional field attribute is pretty powerful. With this, we can show or hide a field, but based on a bunch of conditions. We can specify a condition type, in this case, condition type dot and give the names of the booleans to evaluate, which could be bool functions as well. And it will show the field only when both the conditions are satisfied. We have condition types of AND, OR, NAND, and NOR. They work similar to the corresponding logic gates. We can specify a condition we want to negate from this by creating a bool array. So if we add new bool, false, true in this order, it will negate the second condition because it is true and won't negate the first condition. True means it will basically evaluate something similar to using the NOT operator on the corresponding condition. The foldOut group attribute lets us display the specified fields in a foldout. This is where void comes in handy. We can specify some fields, use a serialized void group holder, and use this attribute. We can give it a name and then pass the name of all the fields manually. We can pass in 2 floats after the group name to specify the width of the label and the field. We can also pass in a bool to draw the group inside a box. We would also have to hide all the fields manually using the hide in inspector attribute. This is done to avoid duplicating the fields. Toggle group attribute allows us to display the specified groups in a toggleable group instead of a foldout. This is straightforward. The horizontal group attribute draws all specified fields horizontally. We have to use a void holder and simply group them together. The fields need to be serialized, but we shouldn't want them to show in the inspector. Therefore, we have to use hide in inspector to avoid duplicating the fields. Vertical group attribute does the same thing, but displays all fields vertically. This is best used alongside horizontal groups to display fields in tabs. Really cool. The final attribute for today is the data table attribute. It draws the members of a serialized struct or a class in a table. This is so simple and straightforward. Whatever struct or class we have, display all its members on a table. We can also use this on arrays, which is pretty cool. You can also use a boolean to draw in a box and another boolean to show labels as parameters in the data table attribute. Here's an example of how you can use multiple attributes in harmony with one another and a practical use case where they are just so handy. Now, this is a repetitive task and it's important to stay organized. Let me explain how I made this very quickly. This is the player script and I have all my variables ready. Properties of jump force and crouch speed are enabled only when they can jump and crouch. Below it are the variables for a completely different section for attacking. And a weapon prefab is required. All of these variables are hidden in the inspector and will be redrawn with the grouping attributes. You can see that I've shifted all of my code for customizing the inspector inside regions. For each block, you can create a region by writing #region and give it a name, and you can close it with #endregion. You can then put all your code inside it. This way, all the clutter won't get in your way during development. So make sure to use regions. For the attack block, I changed the color, added a header, made a foldout group, and grouped all the attack variables. For the movement, I added a header and then created three horizontal group holders for movement, jumping, and crouching. I added GUI colors wherever I want and hidden them in the inspector. And finally, on top of everything, I added a vertical group holder that groups the three horizontal group holders together. And this holder is the only thing that is not hidden in the inspector. Does that make sense? This gives us one giant vertical box over three horizontal boxes. Another example would be this playtesting script. Buttons are really handy in this case. I created a bool called isTesting and I've made it so that all fields will only get enabled if I set this to true. And I've created an array of teleport points. I've added an integer next teleport point index to switch between points, and just for fun, I made it read only. And finally, I created a function to teleport between teleport points and assigned a button which enables on isTesting. We can use a button with a parameter as well, but I find smashing buttons more fun. You can see how they become really useful. It's not mandatory to use them, but it will greatly save your time in the long run. And that's it. Let me know what you think about the package and make sure to check out the developer's channel. Link below. So take care. See ya. Bye-bye.